Have a look at this place. The Ronda Bridge, Spain, Andalusia. This place has got the most amazing food. You've got the mountains and all their mountain food. You've got the seaside, all the fish. And this place has had so much history. It's been taken over by the Romans, the Moors from North Africa. So you've got this whole mix of different flavours going on, from spices, citrus fruits. You know, it's really clever cooking. So I'm here, I'm going to get off the beaten track, I'm going to check it out and do a nice bit of cooking. Brilliant. You cannot come to Andalusia and not talk about tapas. Look at all this beautiful stuff. It's said that the word tapas came from the word tapa, which means to cover. And in the old days, they think it's largely led by the men sort of playing cards or having a drink and stuff. And in the old days, before bottles, they had the wine in kind of clay pots. The flies would be coming around and they cover it with either like a clay plate or even bits of cheese and meat to stop it going in, you know? And from that came the whole philosophy of tapas, little plates. I love the idea, you can come and get a beer and a bunch of different stuff, it's great. So paprika, the nice thing about tapas for me is there's so many different flavours. You've got meat, you've got fish, you've got vegetarian.
It's fast food. The fast food is not a US invention, it's an Andalusian invention.
So fast food originated here, so we've got you to blame for it. What we got coming out here then, darling?
Well, we have a little bit of fish.
Yeah.
This is a fish stick.
So good.
Yeah.
Nice and simple. So, for the regular Spanish person, the philosophy of good tapas is, what are you looking for?
Well, of course, you know, like everybody, you know, you have to make them attractive to the eyes, because food, as you know, comes first through the eyes.
So they say, I want that, 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 exactly. And that, and a beer, or whatever.
Most of them, they don't even ask what is in.
Really?
Because they trust us.
I mean, that's the nice thing about tapas. It's bits and pieces, it's different textures, different colours. Oh, my God. That is amazing. Pork cheeks. They must have been cooked long and slow. I mean, that is heavenly. And your name, Paprika?
My name, Paprika Wall. This is my real name is Carmen. But my father says I was born red, as a red pepper, as a chili, you know?
Really?
And so he called me Paprika, like a chili.
So that's your nickname?
Yes.
Well, I love it. I'm going to do a lovely dish that I'm really, really excited about. It's the kind of food that I love to cook when I'm at home. It's the most delicious tomato salad with chorizo. You know, chorizo is a big deal out here. It's of this area, and any good butcher will sort of like, you know, stake his pride on the quality of his chorizo. And there's loads and loads of different varieties of it. Paprika being an important ingredient, influenced by the Moors. They came with their spices. So I don't want to slice it perfectly, sort of odds and sods, and put the chorizo in. A little bit of olive oil. Now what's gonna happen in this pan is it's gonna start rendering out all that lovely natural fat and flavor. We wanna get this crispy, and we're gonna turn that into like a warm dressing, okay, for these tomatoes. This whole area of Andalusia, you know, is famous for its pigs. I'm under an acorn tree, I found one. That little mama, is what amazing pork is all about. You've got the Iberico breed, which is obviously the classic breed of around here, because they can put up with, you know, lovely hot weather, cold winters, and when they're out here foraging, eating mainly acorns and wild herbs and berries and stuff like that, they put on fat, which makes them incredibly delicious. Can you see the color of that oil? Beautiful. I mean, for a perfect tomato salad, just cut it up. Not imperfect. I don't like it when it's slices or wedges. Just do it all different. A little bit of shallot or scallion just helps to create a little bit of a hum. And then just a nice pinch of black pepper. a good pinch of sea salt, and then some good olive oil. Absolutely one of the hero ingredients of Spain. And another ingredient, sherry vinegar, right? It's absolutely brilliant. It's from this region. You can get it in all the supermarkets back home now. When you taste it as a vinegar, it's not just acid. It's kind of got flavor. There's a tiny bit of sweetness in there. Go and get some and it'll transform your dressings. And then herb-wise, I mean, parsley's a big deal out here, so we can take some of that. You know, I've picked some beautiful little globe basil or tiny basil from the flower pots where I'm staying. Beautiful. And then I want you to roll it up almost like a little cigar and just slice it up. A bit like the tomatoes, a bit sort of erratic, really. Rough. And just sprinkle that over like that. In 5 minutes, the flavour of those tomatoes, because of the beautiful things you put on it, will be ridiculous. Now, there's no garlic in there, right? This is where the magic happens. You know, if you're having a little dinner party, you're cooking for family, just for sort of like getting the vibes going and all that, do your tomato salad, but have this frying around so the room's smelling lovely and delicious. And then at the very last minute, you just finely slice a bit of garlic. As soon as that hits that pan, it's going to completely transform the smell of the room. Angle that little baby and put in the garlic. Yeah. Look at that. Right. And at this point, right, you want to watch the garlic like a hawk. As it just starts taking on colour, a few tablespoons of the vinegar will stop that frying process. It'll sort of smell pretty like, intense for a minute, but it'll cook the vinegar away, and then you're left with that sweetness and flavour. And that's when I go over to my tomato salad and just check this out. Look at that. The lovely crispy chorizo. And you can put some of that lovely fat in there as well. What I love to do is this oil here, right? You can put some of it in, absolutely, because there's mega flavor there. But then with this leftover oil, don't throw it away. Put it in a little jam jar and put it in the fridge. And the next time you roast a chicken, just smear it over it and it'll be like the best thing you've ever eaten. And with this, look at it. You got the red and the dark. Look how dark this chorizo's gone, right? Looks almost burnt. Delish. Right, so we got a beautiful tomato salad. So what I wanna do is I just wanna serve this as a little plate, the way I like to have it. I've got some ham, a few slices. Got a little bit of goat's cheese. Instead of slicing it or grating it, go in with a knife and just sort of create like lovely nuggets. And just put them there, just next to the ham. I mean, it's a funny thing though. I mean, so many people live their whole life making the most boring tomato salads. There's no need to. Go out and get a bit of chorizo, make it with a little bit of love and care. Look at that. Brilliant. And then some sherry. And basically, life don't get much better than that. Fantastic tomato salad with chorizo. Have a look at this. Beautiful ham, some goat's cheese, some hot toasted bread. One of the best tomato salads in the world. Little glass of sherry. Bob's your uncle, one of the best things in the world. You've got to go and do that. Okay, so basically I've done a few mental things in my time. We're doing paella, right? And we want to get a head round it, proper paella. But instead of doing it for 10 or 20, we're going to do it for 500 people. All of these people here. Obviously, the important thing about the paella is the pan. A flat pan, a big pan. This is probably the biggest pan I've ever seen. So, let's see. Yeah, big boy. Okay, so we've got garlic in, red peppers, green peppers, olive oil. I ain't giving you no quantities on this recipe, guys. You're going to have to use your common sense. Oh, mate, where have you been all my life? Then some lovely chopped up onions. It looks like the whole village has turned out. Ooh, tomatoes go in and you just slowly sweat it off. They call this a sofrito to give that base, that lovely flavour. Then we're going to put in some meat, some rice, some seafood. It's mental. Never done anything like this before. So they got shoulder and neck meat of pork, cut up small. We got chicken in now. Pork's in, veg is cooked down. I mean, this has been cooking now for about 50 minutes. I reckon we'll be another 40 minutes yet. It's quite an investment. A lot of hungry people. The sun's going down on us. Kilos of rice going in now, and it's important that every single grain of rice gets treated the same. They've got some chicken stock and some fish stock made out of prawn heads. Now it's getting funky. Squid's going in, so we've got some mussels coming in now and their juice, just some regular peas. That's a pretty aggressive season. You had a little taste. It tastes pretty damn good to me. So about 2 hours 20 minutes, we're basically done. He's now garnishing it with some prawns in there, mussels on the shell. Un aplauso, por favor! What a mission. Now we've got to eat it all. Are you hungry? Hungry? Yeah. So, 2.5 hours, now we've got to carry it to the square. Vamos.
My lord.
Time to serve it up. There you go, gorgeous. Don't eat it all at once. Come on, beato, beato. This is an honour for me because these guys have got the world championship for the best serrano cutters in the whole of the world, Spain as well. So last year his dad had it, this year my main man's got it. We've got different porks here. You can see over here we've got a white haired pig. You can see it's got a white coloured hock, and then here, negra.
Negra.
Pata negra means black hoof. Show us how you do your thing, brother. Now this is a 4 acorn quality. You know, like you get rosettes or Michelin stars. In the Iberico ham world, they have acorns. So this is a 4 acorn, and the best you can get is 5 acorn. Beautiful. This pig here has lived up a mountain all his life. His kind of star rating is 5 acorns. You can tell the quality because the fat, when you rub it, it just jellifies and goes into like a cream.
Desaparece.
Oh, you can tell the fat on that. That fat is so soft.
Sí, más. Más intenso.
Oh my God. That tastes amazing. This is like the Ferrari.
The Ferrari?
Yeah. This is like the
Audi.
Audi. Audi V10. Nice. This one is like a Skoda.
Yeah.
Could you teach me how to use the cortello?
El corte.
So nice and gentle. Ah. Scusa. Sorry, Papa. Feel the force, Luke. No, that's not the force. Now Dad's given me his lightsaber. I'm ashamed. Do you know what I mean? I'm quite good at doing salmon, razor thin, but I've got the two world champions of serrano carving. I'm feeling a bit of pressure here. No. My body. Seriously? Just feel that love. He's right. Come on!
Okay.
Nice one, that's it. Right, what I'm gonna do now is the most delicious killer pork chops with creamy Spanish beans. So, you got these lovely pork chops here, right? You can see you've got that lovely eye meat, you got the brown piece here. I personally like that because you get two different flavours, the sort of sticky and sweet, and then the nice sort of leaner meat there, and then you've got the rib meat here. Really, really good. Now, a little tweak on getting some extra flavour going on, right? It's dead simple, it's not chefy. Go in to your pork chop, get your knife halfway in, like that. And once it's in, sort of move it around slowly, right? And basically, you're making a little pocket there for flavour. And then get your little finger, just poke it in there like that, right? And you know it's all good. Okay, once you've done that, what I want to do is make just like a zingy little filling. So I've got a little bit of oregano in pestle and mortar, just literally a couple of sprigs worth, a pinch of salt for seasoning. I've got some of these nice local raisins. Run your knife through them just to break them up a little bit. And this has got beautiful sweetness. Give it a good old bash. And once you've bashed that up a little bit, I'm gonna put a little bit of my sherry, a couple of tablespoons, just to moisten it up a bit, and a tiny bit of olive oil. Right, so I'm gonna let that just sort of sit for a moment. The raisins will just suck up that moisture and it'll be just like a kind of paste, right? So bear with me on that. Now, in a pan here, I'm gonna fire it up, sort of medium-large heat. See, I've got the bits of fat here from the Pata Negra store. I'll put it in a pan and you see it just literally, like a candle, starts to melt. Look at that, nice. In the store, they had the little offcuts, right, that you can buy, and you can use Parma ham bits for this if you can't get Pata Negra back home. These are the offcuts, I'm gonna put these in as well. Mega flavour, and that's the beginning of this bean dish, right? It's dead simple, it takes 10 minutes to do. Right, then I'll cut my onion up, and you see that pan's getting nice and hot now. Bit of olive oil just to help the story. There we go, the onions are softening. I'm gonna slice up a nice red pepper, and then in with these little babies. Okay. You know, depending on what herbs you've got, you know, if you want to put a couple of bay leaves in, put a few bay leaves. If you wanted to get a little bit of rosemary, just run your knife roughly through that. It's all good stuff. The nice thing is you can use different ingredients like tomatoes and bits and pieces if you want to. You've got these lovely jarred beans, which are literally an off-the-shelf product. You can get them in tins, in jars, and, you know, just scatter them in. They're great quality. These beans here are called habichuela, but you can use any beans you like, honestly. It works whichever one you do. Look at the colours. So exciting. So I'm going to turn the heat down now. I'm going to add a little cup of water. And this will be lovely and creamy. Just literally just cover the beans, and that's going to be great. Right, so let's get this raisin paste. Let's have a look at it. Right, you can see it's quite pasty. You've got the herb in there, the raisins. Have a taste. Sweetness, sherry, herb. It's going to be great. Really, really nice. So just take that little paste here and put it into that pocket that we've made. And just push it in. You don't need much at all to make the whole world a difference. And I don't really want to get it on the outside. I want to keep the outside really plain and simple and normal. And then inside, when you cut into it, juice comes out. Brilliant. So a little bit of pepper on a plate and the pork, a little bit of salt, you want to season it good, a little olive oil on the plate and the pork, and then we're just going to pat it, and then the underside, which hasn't got the salt, just move that around on the plate then, and then you should have a perfect seasoning. And then over to your barbecue. To create a bit of smoke and big up the charcoal cooking, I'm just going to whip off the bars. I've got a few extra bay leaves and herbs and, you know, bits like that. They'll smoke, right? But they'll smoke in a nice way. And that's what barbecuing's about. Okay, so the pork chops are on. Let's check the beans. Look at that. See how nice and creamy that's getting. Have a look at that, baby. Obviously, you can do it under the grill, in an oven, in a hot pan with a little oil. But, you know, barbecue is where it's at, really. Let's turn it over again. You know, it's all about building up colour and flavour. Look at that, just dancing on the top. That's the best bit, when that fat starts doing that. These beans are ready now, but just before they're ready, for the last kind of minute of the beans cooking, I'm just going to put this chard in. You don't want to cook the hell out of the flavour, you know, whether it was spinach or chard or things like stinger nettles and stuff like that. I mean, it's good to have that little bit of life going at the last minute to make it just delicious. Look at that. That is just exactly what I'm looking for. Let's plate this baby up. Look at that. When you can toss it like that, you know it's creamy and delicious. Just gonna pour that in. Nice little portion goes in like that. And then give it a little shake. Look at that. Whether you're cooking it on a barbecue or in a pan, while it's hot and sizzling, plonk that in the middle. The pork will start to rest in the beans. Right, and then I like to pick some little baby leaves of herbs and just put them in and around the top. Some good Spanish olive oil, and that is so good. And like, if you want to see what's happening with this pork, I'll cut into this, and that's what you get. Cut that open, see, you've got that flavour in there. So as soon as you put your knife and fork through there, you get lovely, normal pork chop, you know, unadulterated. Then in the middle, bang, raisins, fruit, flavour, herb. Let's have a little try. Oh my God. Ridiculous. So good. Totally tender and juicy. No need to have tough old pork. We have a beautiful church. Behind the church is a Carmelite convent with 8 nuns that run it, and they're famous in this whole area for doing incredible cakes and biscuits. Now, here's the score. They're a closed order, which means that us lot can't see them, but the lady there speaks English. Let's see what we can get. Look at these lovely cakes. Some really beautiful biscuits, all packaged up nice. And that little one in there, the torta de la Virgen, little flat, crispy ones. I've been buying that in a Spanish place in England for years now, and they're incredible, really snappy. But I didn't really know what I was eating, I just liked it. Right, let's do it. I'm a bit nervous.
Sí, Dios gracias.
Hello, sister.
Hello.
Would it be possible to get some cakes, please?
Yes, sure. Have a look at the window display, because that's what we have.
Yeah, I kind of like it all. It looks beautiful.
Buy them all.
Do you have any of the torta de virgen?
Yeah, but it's got to be a dozen.
Okay.
Okay. That's 250.
250.
Okay. Careful, I'm going to spin round.
Okay.
Careful with your hands.
This is so exciting. Where in England can you go where this happens?
Okay.
I hope that's the right change there, sister.
Before you leave.
Look at this little beauty. These are an absolute triumph of a biscuit. They're snappy, they're crispy, they're sweet. They have like the granular sugar on top. Is that caraway seeds, sister?
It's aniseeds.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Mmm. I love it. I'd love to try your sultanas.
There.
Oh, lovely, look at those. Oh, what a delight.
We call it sultanas, but the American people, when they come over, they call it macaroons. People love them, eh?
That's wonderful. These are delicious. Isn't this beautiful? So this is like a little small holding. There's loads of these in Spain in the countryside. He's a neighbour to where I'm staying. He makes his own wine. We've got fig trees, fruit trees, cherries. He's got apricots over there. Yep. These peaches. Oh my lord. Straight up, I've never had a peach off the tree before, that's brilliant. I want to make a spaccio, so I'm after some killer tomatoes. Little peppers, nice and crunchy. Homemade, homegrown garlic. Look at these lovely cucumbers, absolutely lovely. I know it's different to the ones we have at home, but you peel them and they're delicious and firm and great in gazpacho. It's been really interesting in the last, you know, few days, just seeing people making gazpacho as a matter of course. How often do you make this? Every day. Oh, how often do you have it? Every day. And they have it in cups as well. You know, so all of those years as chefs are seeing it in posh little bowls, you know, we've sort of lost the point of it. So the most important thing about gazpacho, number one, is quality rosy red tomatoes. You want to get rid of the stalk and get rid of the skin, okay? So normally make gazpacho, you put it in the fridge, you chill it, right? If you want it to go straight away, just put a few little ice cubes in like that, just a handful, and then go in with your tomatoes. I want to do about, say, five nice big juicy tomatoes. Gazpacho came over with the Romans when they were running this gaff. You know, it was kind of cucina povera, poor people's cooking. It was about oil off the trees and bread. And bread and oil have always kind of been best friends, but the stale bread would be soaked in water. You know, if they had some rancid wine or something like that, a little bit of vinegar, they put a bit of water, a bit of vinegar in there, some stale bread, soak it. Then they used to pound it up in a pestle and mortar and add oil to it like a sort of emulsion, and that was their soup. So that was the basis of gazpacho. Another tomato in there. I'm using their local cucumbers here. The skin's a little bitter on cucumber, so we'll get rid of that. Again, very refreshing. You know, tomatoes, cucumber, these things are like 90% plus water. Peppers, peppers are important. Green, you want to get rid of that white pithy bit there. So a nice little bit of pepper action, let's say one of those. It's the smell of these peppers that give you the flavour of the gazpacho. That is the smell of gazpacho that you've got right there. Okay, let's get a bit of bread. This is bread from a day ago, so it's sort of stale-ish. Can put the crusts in. I'm just going to take them off, mostly. Stale bread, leftover bread, just about every country I know in the world has a use for it. So let's pour some water on the bread, just to soak it up a little bit. Just squeeze it with your hands, it'll just suck it up like a sponge. And while that's soaking, garlic, really important. Two cloves of garlic going here. So we're gonna put the bread in here like this. And then we're just gonna kick it up with some olive oil. Look at that. Nice bit of the old Spanish olive oil. Spain still makes more olive oil than anywhere else in the world. Okay, a little bit of sherry vinegar. I'm not as confident as the locals, so I'm gonna taste it later. And then I get my blender. I always feel like Delia when I do this, and I love Delia. Look at it all change. You can see that bread straight away start thickening and going creamy. Right, let's have a little taste up. Right, we need salt, a bit more oil. I mean, in England, you're probably used to seeing gazpacho much redder. And that's probably because there's no bread in it. But, you know, it's very authentic to use bread out here. It does give it more of a kind of body and a sort of creaminess. It's got the ice in it, so it's already really cold. Lovely to serve it in just a tray of ice like that. And they always serve it in glasses. Rarely do you get it in a posh old bowl. But the one thing you definitely must do, just put a little bit of olive oil on top like that. Basically, whatever country you come from, when the tomato's good, it's time to make this little baby. It's so refreshing, so good. Delicious. I'm just going to knock up something that I've seen around. And they use these little quail eggs. Have a look at that, beautiful little things. And they're only tiny, so you can have a couple of them. But they're so cute. My kids would go mad for these. Got some toast on. I've got some more chia, which is like a black pudding. You know, just like the black pudding back home in England, it's made out of pig's blood, fat, bits of pork, and then it's the condiments that make it really special and regional. Look at the colour of that fat that's come out. This one's got the paprika in, that lovely distinctive red colour. You'd never get that in England. Clove, cinnamon, and a little oregano, which is lovely. And then what I want to do is, now I've got that toast, just slice a tomato, then you rub that bread, and that'll suck up all the juice. A little bit of olive oil over the top, right? And often they just eat it like that with a pinch of salt. But then I'm gonna add some nice pata negra. Look at that. And then I've got these lovely little fried eggs. The little quail egg, just like that. Beautiful. Quail's eggs are really cute. You can get them in all the supermarkets. You know, part of me have always felt they're a bit sort of posh, kind of like, you know, Anglo-French sort of, you know, poached quail eggs with celery salt and all that sort of business. Nice at picnics and afternoon tea. But they're really cool. I really love them. And that's basically it. Got three nice toasties. It's like three of the best mouthfuls in the world. And then on the side, I'm gonna put this black pudding. I'm just gonna do a little pile of fried crispy bits like that. And that, I just can't wait to eat that. One thing that I'm gonna do that's completely not Spanish is I've got some chilies. Chilies over the top. And that's my breakfast, marvelous. Look at that little baby. Look at this perfect little mouthful, brilliant. And what I love to do is just get my finger or a fork and just bust the egg yolk and then just let the yolk go all the way around and then eat it. That is so good. What a combination. And look at this. How nice is this? And you can see from the buildings behind, you know, they're kind of Moorish in style. And it's that Moorish influence that kind of spices this little baby and the chorizo and stuff like that. Mmm. Such a good breakfast. Okay, so I'm down here on the Costa del Sol. I've bought some lovely fish, some beautiful dorade, or we call them bream. I've had it gutted, and then I've left the scales on. Very important when you want to cook fish whole in salt, because they kind of protect the fish. Now, when you cook fish in salt, it does something incredibly, I don't know, it's like you're creating your own little kiln or oven. So first things first, normally what the Spanish would do is just get some water and put it in with the salt, to kind of make it sort of a little bit slushy, so that they can kind of make almost like a sandcastle out of it. So I'm gonna get that water and just mix it up like that, right? And I always suggest that if you wanna get it right first time, just one egg like that, right? Reason being, this helps the salt to be claggy and almost set and go a bit harder. And then what you can do is actually flavor that salt. So just little bits of lemon. Going in there like that. Some fennel seeds. It does make a difference to the actual sort of steaming and the flavour of the fish. So I've lit the fire. What I want to do is just push half of it away over there and then basically put half of it straight onto those rocks there. I'm going to stuff this bream with a little thyme. You could use basil, parsley stalk. Right, that stuffing's gonna stop the salt going in. So push that fish in like that. What I'd normally suggest to do at home, because you can do this at home so easily, is actually get the oven on about 200 degrees and put the salt in a roasting tray. So I'm gonna put that fish there, and then I'm gonna put this salt on top. Like that. Here we go. Look at that. Just mound that over like that. You can just put a bit of the old tin foil. And I'm going to grab this coal here, put it back over. There we go. I'm going to give it about 20 minutes. Right, let's leave that. So what I'm going to do now is make a lovely side for the fish, right? Alioli. It's a classic Spanish dish from this part of the world, and it's basically based around celebrating the garlic and great oil. So I've got 3 cloves of garlic in there, right? I'm doing something totally not classic. I'm going to put in a little pinch of saffron, right? Still worth more than gold to this day by weight. So I'm going to put that in with the garlic. Just that tiny little bit will make all the difference. And then I'm going to have a pinch of salt. That's so it's abrasive. Look at the colour already. That garlic's gone from being like absolutely white, like snow. And it's as I'm pounding that beautiful saffron, it's sort of rehydrating it. So what we're going to do, we've creamed up the garlic. And the garlic is going to act as our emulsifier. See how small the oil is that I'm putting in here? 70 mils of a cheap but clean olive oil, i.e. nothing too exciting, quite mellow. And this takes about 3 or 4 minutes, right? Now, I want to give you a warning. This sauce is genius, right? It's got attitude, so a little goes a long way. But there you go. Serve it at the table, one of those. Bang. I'm going to make a quick little cucumber and olive salad, just like that. So I've got some nice green olives here. Probably black would be prettier, but this is what they have here. Sweet peppers. I'm just going to use one. A couple of bits of parsley, just a squeeze of lemon juice, you know, to bring the salt out of those olives. And some of that great olive oil. That's got summertime written all over it. Look at that. And leave that for about 10 minutes. Bring that salt out of the olives. You'll find that salad getting better and better and better. Right, let's get on with the business. This fish must be done now. Peel that tin foil off. Give it a little crack. Almost like doing a boiled egg. Crack around the edge. It should be like a lid. Look at that. See the juice coming out of it? That's what that investment is in. That's where that crazy idea is in, right? That moisture kept in the fish. Okay, let's plate this little baby up. You can get some and you can just sort of flake it. And the whole point of this kind of cooking is that it is tactile. Just slide it off the plate so it doesn't fall apart. And then look at some of those natural juices there. That's what it's all about. Getting that alioli. And just be proud and do a big old confident lump. You know, this is recipes that are steeped in hundreds of years of care and effort and common sense. And I swear to God, these Spanish, they really know how to cook. Nice. And don't forget that juice there. Just a little bit over the fish. Look at that. Let's have a try of this stuff. To just get that lovely bit of fish there. Look how moist that is. Get some of that alioli, and that is going to be really good. Look at that. Oh my lord. That is fish, the best fish I've ever had. Well, you've got to try that. You've got to try that. Basically, all this chaos here is a big festival of the sea to celebrate the Virgin del Carmen, which is basically the fishermen's sort of their saint, really. So there's a church up in the village, a bunch of strapping lads pick up the carved figure of the Virgin, and then they walk her through the town, they come onto the beach, they put it on a raft, and then they float it all around these fishing boats, and that will give all the fishermen good luck for the...
Thank you.
Where's the Virgin? Where's the Virgin?
Spanish omelette.
Spanish omelette.